Fourth Sunday of Lent. Deep into Lent. Okay. Let us pray. Heavenly Father, we want to thank you for all the blessings. We want to thank you for your Son. We want to thank you for your church. We want to thank you for each other. We want to thank you for sending your Holy Spirit to help us pray, to give us the words, to give us the songs, to activate us, to give the proper response to you and your revelation, which is faith. And let us be true and honest, and most of all, let us love one another. In Jesus' name, amen.
We have a little extra this morning. Christy's in New Orleans, loving, without all of us. Isn't that amazing? But I have my directions for the announcements. First of all, remember that for members of the church, there's a $48 per capita that we'd love to have you contribute as soon as possible. Many of you have turned in pledge cards for 2024. That helps us to really look at the budget for next year and what sort of resources we have to plan activities and services and everything within the church. Prayer group is online every Tuesday at 6:30 p.m. The Zoom link is in your flyer, in your bulletin. And send your prayer requests either to Christy, and she's reading all that. She'll be on a plane on Tuesday, so send them to office at First Pres. We'll make sure that the prayer group gets them. Otherwise, call Teresa Porterfield or somebody on prayer group. This afternoon, as you know, is Hal Clayson's memorial service. He did so much for our church for so many years. It's at 2 o'clock here in our sanctuary with a reception following. We're really excited about Carrie, right up there, Hernandez, doing a modified yoga chair yoga series, and that starts March 14th and March 21st, 28th, 4th, April 4th at 3:30. All are welcome. Donations are appreciated, and you could talk to Christy or myself about that. We have Pastor Sam's one-year celebration on March 17th, so that's coming up. He's been such an asset to our church. We are thrilled to celebrate with him. And then, one great hour of sharing. You'll see some of the handouts in the pews. This is for Presbyterian disaster assistance, hunger assistance, community development. However, there's two separate envelopes. So if you are donating to One Great Hour of Sharing, make sure your giving goes into this. Or if you put it in my offering, indicate on it by writing which it's for. Okay? I think that's it. What? Oh, thank you. It's written right here. Bob Urbacher, as we announced, I think, last week, has passed away. Funeral services will be shared when we have that information, the location and times and all of that. Okay? Thank you.
Good morning. Please join with me at the call to worship. Please stand first. Oh, give thanks to the Lord, for God is good. God's steadfast love endures forever. Let the redeemed of the Lord say so, whose God, whose redeemed trouble and gathered from the lands, and from the east and from the west, from the north and from the south. Let them thank the Lord for God's steadfast love, for God's wonderful works to humankind. And let them offer thanksgiving sacrifices and tell of the Lord's deeds with songs and joy.
Please remain standing and join in singing our opening hymn, O God, Creation's Secret Forms.
Let us now pray the prayer confession printed in your bulletin or up on the screen. Holy God, giver of all that is good, we rejoice that you are the source of all that is. The breath of life is a gift from your generous hand. The food we eat is grown in the world you sustain. The community that supports us is called into being by your saving activity. Everything we have is a gift from you. Why then do we complain as though the manna raining down from heaven for us now is not enough? Why do we worry that your well of living water will someday run dry? It is surely our sin that causes us to live as though we do not trust your forgiveness. Forgive us, we pray. Teach us to put all our trust in your promises that never fail. Remind us that we are always in your loving care. Fill us with grace so that our lives might show forth the fullness of your love for all people. My friends, know that God sends angels and saints to remind us that we fall short. Sometimes we forget God. Sometimes we forget the ways of Christ. But know that once we repent and open up our hearts to God and ask for forgiveness, through Jesus Christ we are forgiven. Thanks be to God. Amen.
And now is the time for us to celebrate and share our cares and our prayers. Pastor Sam will pass around the mic.
Good morning. As you know, I've asked for prayers for my sister Dixie in the past. I got a phone call this past week that she's in the hospital, not doing very well, so just continue to pray for my sister Dixie. Thank you.
Good morning. As some of you know, my mom has contracted shingles, and it's been very painful for her and caused her to have a lot of intermittent sleep, but she's doing a little better, and so feel free to give her a call this week or even visit her if you feel like driving 8 miles each way to go see her, but she'd probably appreciate your love and care. And my son's doing better. He's going back to school tomorrow after 3 weeks on crutches, so making a good recovery. Thank you.
That's a good reminder. Take your shingles vaccine, please. There you go, Steph.
Good morning, everyone. I'm Stephanie Martisich, who's been coming to this church since I could walk and talk. It's the 21st annual LA Harbor International Film Festival beginning this week on Thursday, and every year I've stood here and invited the entire congregation to come as our guests for free. Well, this is free for everybody all the time, although donations are acceptable. This poster, and there are in the narthex. And I'd like to point out, I know Gordon's been over the years and so many. Saturday night, having our Hollywood, what am I doing wrong here? Our Hollywood Nostalgia Tribute aboard Battleship Iowa. And the film is Anchors Away, starring Frank Sinatra, Katherine Grayson, Gene Kelly, who has the famous scene dancing with Jerry the Mouse, the MGM Mouse. He actually had an Oscar nomination for that, and since it's the Academy Award Day, that's apropos. We hope everybody will come and enjoy that. The only cost is the parking. The little restaurant there will stay open late and have a special for our guests. It should be a lot of fun. And pick up a program card to know the rest of it. But we'd love to see you all there. Thank you.
Anyone else?
Peggy's feeling a little under the weather, so.
Oh, thank you. Prayers for Peggy.
Please pray for my dear friend Lois, whose 13-year-old granddaughter hung herself. And she can hardly manage right now. She's just beside herself.
I've asked for prayers for my Uncle Carlos, who's been in the hospital with cancer. They really can't do much for him anymore. He's going to go to hospice. So pray for Carlos.
Members had heard that our former member Bob Erbacher passed away this week.
God of love, we ask you to surround these people that are suffering right now. We are lifting up people, God. We're lifting up the Erbacher family. We're lifting up Al Clayson's family, Sandy, and all the children. We're lifting up Lois, and as her daughter has so sadly decided that it was just too tough. God, we just ask for comfort for Carlos, and you surround him in the dark hours and let him know that there is so much light and so much hope. God, we ask, we're We ask that Dolores' tuber is able to sleep, Father. We ask that shingles pain is lifted. We are celebrating Gordy's healing, God, that it's so good that he's able to go back to school, even though he might not think so. We thank you so much for a celebration of film, God, that we can learn new things and we can enjoy each other's company. And we ask for prayers for Peggy and continued prayers for Gwen Brown, Joanne. Father God, your hand is with us and over us and watching us all the time with love. We're praying for Ukraine and Russia. We're praying for Israel, Gaza. People are suffering, and we ask for them to have a relief. We pray for the people that are traveling, God, that they are safely. And we thank you for this church and our family here, that we know we can depend on them for prayer and love. And in your mighty name, ask you to join me in the Lord's Prayer. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever. Amen. Now is the time that we greet each other and pass God's peace.
All right. Whoa. Sorry about that. Welcome back, everybody. Welcome back. Please rise and join in singing "Open the Eyes of My Heart." Thank you.
of my heart, I want to see you. I want to see you. Open the eyes. Open the eyes of my heart, Lord. Open the eyes of my heart, I want to see you. I want to see you. See you high. See you high, lifted up, shining in the light of your glory. Pour out your power and love as we sing, holy, holy, holy. Open the eyes of my heart, Lord. Open the eyes of my heart. I want to see you. I want to see you. Open the eyes of my heart, Lord. Open the eyes of my heart. I want to see you. I want to see you. To see you high. See you high, lifted up, shining in the light of your glory. Pour out your power and love as we sing, holy, holy, holy. To see you high, lifted up, shining in the light of your glory. Pour out your power and love as we sing, holy, holy, holy. Holy, 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 holy. I want to see you. Holy, 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 holy. I want to see you.
See you.
Holy, holy, holy.
That's beautiful. God of all wisdom and glory, grace us today with the presence of your Spirit, that we might hear today's word with understanding and imagination. This we pray in your holy and good name. Amen. Today's scripture comes from John 3, 14 through 21. And just as Moses lifted up the serpent in the wilderness, so must the Son of Man be lifted up, that whoever believes in him may have eternal life. For God so loved the world that he gave his only Son, so that everyone who believes in him may not perish, but have eternal life. Indeed, God did not send the Son into the world to condemn the world, but in order that the world might be saved through him. Those who believe in him are not condemned, but those who do not believe are condemned already, because they have not believed in the name of the only Son of God. And this is the judgment, that the light has come into the world, and the people loved darkness rather than light, because their deeds were evil. For all who do evil hate the light and do not come to the light, so their deeds may not be exposed. But those who do what is true come to the light, so they may be clearly seen that their deeds have been done in God.
Thank you, Teresa. Let us pray. May the words of my mouth, the meditations of all our beautiful hearts, be acceptable to you, our love and Redeemer. Amen. So when was the first time you heard the scripture, John 3:16?
Football game.
You see, someone kicks a field goal or some guy in the back goes like this. Anyone else? When's the first time you heard John 3:16? Bible study? Sunday school? Where else? Where else? In-N-Out fries. If you ever look at the bottom of the cup, they have the little verse in there. Interesting, isn't it, Preston?
Stone Cold Steve Austin.
Stone Cold Steve. I didn't know you were a WWE fanatic. Oh boy. I learned something about Preston every day. Anyone else? Of course, I think it's the most famous Bible verse in the world, right? If you talk to any Christian, usually they know Amazing Grace and John 3:16. It's like the moniker. If you're a Christian, you know those two things by heart. I don't think most people know the second and third verse of Amazing Grace, but most people know the first verse of Amazing Grace and John 3:16. But for us as Christians and followers of Christ, what does that mean for us? It's been said so many times, it's on billboards and stuff driving by, but what does that mean for us as Christians? Is it a means to separate us from them and us? People who believe in Christ like us, and for others who don't believe in Christ. Is that what you think it means? What do you think it means? Is this something we just say? Because I want to look us to understand that scripture perhaps in a different way today. Perhaps, what if that message is really for Christians? Not non-Christians, not for non-believers, but what if that passage is really meant for followers of Christ? What does that mean for us? Perhaps a reminder? Perhaps that we go to church every Sunday, we go to sometimes Bible study, we prayer group, and we do the same thing like we're riding a bicycle. Or perhaps we're hamster in a pinwheel. Going around and around. And perhaps sometimes we become normalized to what we do because we were raised in the church, born, baptized, confirmed in the church. But we forget the meanings. We forget what grace means, what love means, what faith means, what even Jesus means. Maybe the reason why you come to church to see your friends or participate in community action. But perhaps this verse is asking us to reset our own values and our own beliefs and start really asking ourselves the question again, what is light? What is darkness? What are your deeds? What does Jesus mean for you today? For the Ioannean community in the Gospel of John, which is unlike the other three Gospels, it's almost like a summation of Jesus' life and ministry in the first few chapters. We saw it last week and this week. And the John 3:16 passage has been used in a way that separates people, but today, what does it mean for you? Reassess that. What does it mean for you that for God so loved the world, not just Christians, that God gave God's only Son, that whosoever believes in him shall not perish but have eternal life? What does that mean for you today? Is following Christ just for you to get to heaven? Is following Christ for you to look good in your community, in your business? What does it mean for you today? I asked a lifelong Roman Catholic friend of mine, and he almost became a priest, which is even more funnier. but he has a beautiful family. And I said, why do you go to church? And he goes, well, he gave me the list, right? Friends, hanging out, blah, blah, blah. I'm like, okay, I get to worship God. That's great. But what does that mean for you in the 21st century? And you have to sit and think about it. What does it mean for wherever you are in life? What does that mean? Yesterday, I was at my friend's mom's funeral. I led the funeral yesterday. And I asked the same question. What does it mean that you're here? What does it mean that we're having a Christian funeral? What does it mean for you to say you love someone? What does that all mean? Is this just gibberish? Is this something that we take for granted every Sunday? And I believe the community of John is asking the community of the Ioannean community to reassess what they believe and what they think. Why do you believe in Jesus? Why do you come to church? What does it mean for you? And then also under reflection is, what does your deeds look like? If you have to take an inventory of your deed for God, what does that look like today? Does that show light? Is it intentional? Is it something just do because you do? Because this latter half of the script passages today challenges us to what? Reflect the light in your deeds. And what does that look like today? What does your deeds look like? Well, Pastor Sam, I do all these things. Oh, that's great. But why do you do all those things? Why do you do volunteer work on Meals on Wheels? Why do you do other things in the community? Why? Maybe you have good parents that trained you well. Or good godparents or aunties and uncles that poke you when you do wrong. But why do you do these things? Why do you believe in Christ at your age? Why should Zion follow the ways of Christ? And those are the things that I believe John is asking, the community is asking the Christians, not the non-believers. Don't use this verse to say, oh, you believe you're going to go to heaven. No, why do you believe? Why do you think this way? What does it mean for you? Especially this time of Lent is a time of really understanding the suffering of Christ, going toward the death on the cross. What does that mean for you in 2021 is the biggest question that we should ask. Yes, God so loved the world, but what does that mean for you? That God sent God's only Son, what does that mean for you? That whoever believes in Him, what is that belief for you? Should not perish, but have eternal life. And what is eternal life? What is eternal life? Eternal life to be in heaven? I won't say the other side. But what does eternal life mean? All these words, all these things that non-Christians don't understand, but as Christians, what does that mean for us? What does that mean for you? Think about that. It's like a time of reassessment. It's a time of understanding why you do things. It's a time of opening more dimensions of our own beliefs. I'm not here to gauge whether you're a good Christian or not. That's between you and God. Whether you're going to go to heaven or not, that's between you and God. But I'm here to poke the bear, your spiritual bear. And I hope you don't bite me, but I'm here to poke you. I'm here to remind you. I'm here to ask you to think again and reassess your values and faith and beliefs in Christ and why you do these things. Because Christ in His life during Lent is going toward the cross to die. And where will you be in that process? Will you just be words? I believe in Jesus Christ, the Lord and my Savior. But what does that mean? And I ask that every time that we come across Scripture and these words, that we reassess where we are in life. Because life changes us. Life does change us. Some people fall away. Some people don't. Some people find God. Some people don't. The funeral yesterday, they have an estranged family member. And that estranged family member showed up. They haven't seen her for 25 years. And somehow, she read the newspaper And somehow she saw her mother, and she showed up after 25 years. You never know. The Spirit works in different ways, and her showing up, I believe, started the process of healing among the siblings. So what does that mean? I think the reality is God is working within you every day. God is sending the Spirit to poke you even more, to change you even more. To times when you think it's hopeless, there is hope. Times when you think that you have it all figured out, the Holy Spirit shakes the bed and throws you out of the bed, and you realize, maybe I just don't know everything I thought I did. But that is what the Spirit does. That is what love does, to push us, to make us realize the new dimensions, the new aspects of Christ, the new understandings of love that's reflected in our lives. So, yesterday's funeral, they hugged their sister that has been estranged for 25 years and they cried. So think about that. There is always hope when we think there is no hope, because God so loved the world. So my friends, my challenge for you today is to take this verse into your heart again and try to understand what it means for you today. Not what it meant for you in grade school and Bible study or in and out or football games. But what does it mean for you today, this fourth Sunday of Lent? And how does that reflect your own faith? Can we do that? I think we can. Amen.
God, you've been so generous to us. Now let us give back a portion of our time, talents, and money. And may the ushers please come forward. Generous God, you remind us that you anoint our heads with oil and that our cup overflows with your abundance. We do not take for granted all that you provide. Take these gifts, use them for the healing and tender care of your hurting world.
Please remain standing and join in singing Love Divine, All Loves Excelling. Thank you.
My friends, you know, tomorrow will be the 1 year that I have been your minister. And it's been an interesting journey that I would end up in San Pedro. Pedro, with amazing people here. Elliot's laughing back there. I saw a miracle today. I saw Jerry dancing, you know, so we have, I believe that the Spirit is working in our congregations in more ways than one. In the year, I've seen laughter, I've seen tears, and today I see Jerry dancing again. I've seen miracles in our church. I've seen love expressed, deeds done. I've seen us struggle. I've seen us also have some PTSD from other struggles before me. I've seen the resiliency and the perseverance of our congregation. And I believe that is a reflection of your love for Christ and our church family. In the next year that will come, and at some point hopefully I'll be installed, I believe that we need to continue to grow. We're not some old animal trying to learn new tricks. We are a new creation. We are changing daily. And I challenge us that in the coming year, we're going to do the Bible in a year, and you'll get bookmarks for it and so forth. We're going to do that and try to relearn scripture, not just fables and stories that or failures of Christmas quizzes and Lenten quizzes and things like that. But I want to reflect to you what I see in our church family. I want to reflect that you do live John 3:16. I want to reflect that you have faith and courage and strength. And I want to thank you for letting me be your pastor for a year. And I want to thank you for allowing me to be a pastor for another year or so. And I praise God and really lift up God's name for our beautiful church. We are growing in different ways, not just numbers. We are growing in our spiritual journey. I know the Spirit works in us through good times and bad times. And know that I will be here. And I want to reaffirm that we will be here as a church community. I love you all. Now may the grace of God.
Love you too.
The fellowship of the Holy Spirit, the life, death, and resurrection of our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ, be with you now and forevermore. Amen.
Shall we sing the Lord's song?